Thank you, everyone. I'm glad to see a pretty big crowd here. I figured this would be a topic people would be interested in, and I'm glad to see everyone's here. So, a little bit about who I am. I actually spent 3 years at DataStax as a Vanguard Solutions Architect toward the end. So, a lot of experience at Cassandra, going back to some of the first Cassandra summits in 2011. So, Cassandra walk. But most recently, I've been working at Confluent. And I generally work with strategic users of the technologies across both the companies. So I've had the opportunity to see architectures that are repeated, patterns that work and have been successful across the industry. So I figured I'd come out and share what I've seen and do a little bit of Kafka 101 at first. Although before I do that, how many people use Apache Kafka? That's pretty impressive, okay. That's about at least half the room. So that's good to see. How many people use Apache Kafka and Cassandra in the same project? It's pretty much the same thing. Okay, awesome. So yeah, I may be preaching to the choir for that group a little bit, but I'm gonna start out with, what is Kafka and why is it important to this? And then I'll kind of dive into the architectures that I've seen combining Kafka and Cassandra to solve the horizontal use cases you see in business. So the more technological platform kind of solutions that I've seen repeated. And then talk about some of the things you think about as you design these architectures. So for those who didn't raise their hand, Kafka is a distributed transaction log. So if you've ever worked with, say, a relational database and it has a redo log in it, or a commit log in Cassandra, the idea of Kafka is that it is a log first and foremost, and it's distributed by nature. So it scales in a very similar way to other distributed technologies, such that you can have this log handle, thousands of writes per second, millions of writes per second, tens of millions of writes per second. You throw hardware at it, it can do it. And it's persistent. So if you've worked with messaging technology in the past, you're used to having queues. And a queue, we push something in, and if something doesn't read it out, our queue gets too deep and we can't perform well. So Kafka is designed to have lots of different consumers of a given event across the organization without impacting each other's ability to read. I think we've all heard about event-driven architectures and ESBs and all that from the last time this all came around. The persistence of Kafka kind of solves a lot of the problems with that issue. And it was originally created at LinkedIn to solve for the problem that they had nosql databases, they had a data lake, they had operational systems, they had lots of different things going on, and they weren't able to get the data into all those in real time at the same time. That's kind of what Kafka was originally designed for. So, it has the scalability of a file system. So it's hundreds of megabytes per second. I've seen gigabytes per second. It's persistent, runs commodity hardware. These sound familiar. Guarantees a database. Kafka is not a database. Kafka is not a database. I'm gonna say that a bunch of times. Because that is a common mistake. You can't query Kafka. You basically read a stream of events out of Kafka. But it does give persistence and ordering. So you can guarantee an order of events within a given partition of Kafka, and I'll talk about what a partition means in this speak, because every data technology has partitions, and they mean something different for everyone. But the idea is it's persistent. So you get that persistent capability that you're not used to from legacy messaging technologies. And it's distributed by design. So this allows us to do high throughputs without bottlenecking on a single machine or having issues with scaling horizontally or vertically. It does both. And it can be continuously running. It has a lot of the same concepts that you're used to from using Cassandra, things like replication factor of 3 that you can set and consistency contracts based on your in-sync replicas and things like that. So it's designed to be distributed for this log. But at the end of the day, this is what Kafka is. I got events, I write them to the end of the topic, and I do that over time. So it allows us to capture an ordered set of events over time at very high volumes without having to sync to disk on every write. That may sound familiar as well. And this allows us to, you know, ingest things from all across the organization at very, very high rates of messaging, but also provide, you know, durability for them. So you can set Kafka retention to an hour, 7 days, 14 days, forever. It's kind of up to you and how much storage you want to have for it. And this allows you to do things like replaying events from the past or rehydrate a database when you spin up a new application. And you know, basically scale out your data infrastructure on demand from the events. And events kind of become the core thing that you work with, because an event is the primitive. Events like an order. An event's like, hey, I changed my email. There's lots of different kinds of events. Could be an IoT sensor reading. But the idea is, from these events, we can build views of data, and then, you know, we could use Cassandra to serve out those views of data at very, very high performance and scalability and multi-data center and all that. So the two kind of allow you to solve some of the challenges of, you know, a NoSQL database, which is, you know, often getting the data from where it sits today. You know, I'm sure there's a few folks in the room that still have data in the mainframe, still in a few Oracle databases and so forth. Kafka kind of provides that log to get that information out and into your modern tier. Oops, I don't need to hit my key. Kafka scales through partitioning, also probably sounds familiar. So if I have a topic called orders, I can say it has three partitions, and it will distribute the data across those partitions based on a key. So if I've got orders by user, I can make the user ID the key, I can make the SKU a key or something like that. And that allows us to provide serialization of certain events, because events sometimes are serial. You can't ship it before that you check their credit card. You know, there's certain things you can't do out of order. So we're able to do that, but also get scalability by distributing that in partitions. You can have 1,000 partitions if you have a lot of concurrency going on, but you still want to have ordering within the message tier. And there are a lot of things where ordering is important. And then Kafka provides a streaming layer, and I'll kind of contrast that a little bit, because this is not like a replacement for Spark Streaming. It's a different technology for a different problem. Kafka provides a stream processing library. So this is not a cluster. It is not a continuously deployable set of nodes that you you work with. This is if I want to do stream processing in my microservice. So instead of submitting a job to a cluster, which is great for things that need to touch lots of data, right? So if I want to do machine learning across my historical set, I'm not going to use Kafka Streams for that. If I'm doing advanced analytics that require a large amount of in-memory data, that's not what Kafka Streams is for. What Kafka Streams is for is, hey, I got orders and I got customer, and maybe I want to put customer data in my order in flight. And this allows you to join that information together, and if we're sourcing from relational databases, denormalize it, which, if you're using Cassandra, is probably going to be useful for you. So we can create lots of different views by doing real-time joins on information as it flows through, and this is code. This is not infrastructure. This is something you deploy in a Spring Boot application and your own Java code. You can write it in Scala too. But the idea is this allows you to do some of these joins, these simple aggregations, these filters. You know, so hey, just filter out everything that's not from Washington D.C. and my orders topic, and make a new topic out of that. So Kafka Streams, the source is always one or more topics. The destination is one or more topics. So the idea is it is modifying data in flight so that it can be put somewhere else. It is not, you know, serving anything. It's not doing, you know, deep analytics. It's very much for, hey, we got data in flight, needs to be enriched, and then everyone else in the organization needs to be able to get at that enriched value of that data in parallel. And that's kind of what Streams is. And that gets really interesting in a lot of these use cases, because we do often have very normalized data or data that doesn't come in a format that matches your query patterns, which, you know, is how we data model in Cassandra. So you need a way to transform it in flight so that it one, gets there fast, but two, is in the structure that you want to use once it lands within Cassandra. So, you know, an architecture might look something like this. We have connectors on the left side. So that's, hey, you know, go to the relational database, get the change log, and publish that as events. It could be a JDBC client doing a query on a database. It could be an MQTT connector that's reading IoT events coming in. And Connect is this framework that allows you to get data in and out of Kafka from and to different destinations. And it's a general purpose framework. So anyone can write a connector. In fact, there is a DataStax connector, if you're a customer of DataStax, that lets you land the data in Cassandra directly without having to write any code. So you can map your table or your topic in Kafka directly to tables in Cassandra and deploy this configuration to a worker, and it'll just do all the work of transforming the data format from JSON or Avro or whatever it's in Kafka to the proper model to write SQL into Cassandra, and it does that for you. So that makes it very easy to connect different systems. And there's a whole ecosystem of connectors, you know, everything from HDFS to, you know, cloud-based file systems, IoT events, syslogs coming in from your applications or your servers. It's a rich ecosystem. And it's a big part of, you know, the talk today, which is Cassandra is a common destination for Kafka data, because one of the things you're really trying to do with Kafka is get the data out of legacy systems, combine that with real-time things, so your modern applications, your microservices, and then serve that to your customers, to your users in a real-time manner. So this is why Kafka and Cassandra are kind of best friends. They really do fit well together, because when we think about how we model data in Cassandra, we model data in Cassandra to serve reads. So we might have tables like orders, customers by order, or no, orders by customer, orders by location, orders. We might have all these different tables that are effectively views into that same data set. There's a few ways to solve for that. One is you can use Kafka with a different connector populating those tables. You can use the materialized views function in Cassandra, and there's trade-offs on each side of that. But the idea is that we're able to get data from wherever it's coming in into Cassandra so that we're not having to always, sometimes we get to greenfield, right? Sometimes we get a project where they're like, you have no legacy complications, just build this. How often is that? Maybe 1 in 10? Wouldn't we all love it if the world worked that way? So the idea is that by using the combination of these technologies, we can combine all that business logic that's in PL/SQL and COBOL and other stuff that's never going to get rewritten in the next 10 years with our modern applications, and then make that available through APIs and other services by landing the data in Cassandra so that you can get high availability user experience to your customers. And that is why I think these two technologies play so well together, and I see it repeated over and over in the field. If you have a mission-critical user-facing application, if you work with Kafka and Cassandra, you're able to provide the best customer experience, the best latency between when that data was generated to when it's available to serve out, you know, so it's not nightly ETL or things like that. And your modern applications can integrate right in with everything else. And this kind of synergy allows for solving some things that were extremely hard to do in the past. So by far the biggest use case, and this might look like a Lambda architecture to you because it is a Lambda architecture, this is what I see over and over and over again as I fly all around the world at this point, is we've got data in databases, and there's not one cylinder over there, is there? There's probably like 50. You got your order system, which doesn't talk to your inventory system, which doesn't talk to your IoT events and so forth. And we need to get that data out of those systems because they can't handle reads. They're not able to scale reads. And then maybe, you know, we need to land it in our data lake or in our DCFS or wherever we're going on the other side. Maybe we have some BI stuff that needs a relational database. You know, there's certain queries that are just not fun for NoSQL. We're able to, you know, fan the data out in lots of different ways. And then we can even have different pipelines. So Cassandra might have a Spark streaming ingest feed that's doing a scoring algorithm based on ML, and then a raw data feed coming in through Connect to serve different tables and different query questions that you have within your architecture. And then you can fan it out to, you know, whoever wants it. So, you know, that could be the cloud over there, because there are Kafka connectors for Kafka, which effectively allow you to get data into another Kafka somewhere else. But you also have the ability to have different pipes into Cassandra. And the thing is there, you see that joins and streams. That really is a huge factor, because when we get change data capture of a relational database, what does it look like? Does it look like, you know, nice enriched orders? No, it's the order has a customer ID in it. That customer ID maps to an address table, which has five different addresses for that customer, which maps to the customer master table. And when you get the data out of a relational database, that's what it looks like. It doesn't look like the golden record for customer. It looks like all these fragmented tables that were updated in at different times or as part of one transaction. You need some way to stitch that back together, denormalize it into something usable. So that's kind of where Kafka Streams comes in, is it provides this layer where I can take two topics coming in, like you see in the red here, stitch them back together, and then output them in another topic, which then feeds all our systems downstream. If I want the raw data to go through too, I can. I can have both the stream processor and the raw connect feed both feed your downstream system. So if you have a use case for it, you can. Or I can just take the enriched information. Or I can deploy a filter. So I create a new stream that's, you know, a subset of that to answer a specific question in Cassandra. And this is something that looks simple on here because it is. But if you've tried to implement something like this today, most places, you get a spider web of ETL, right? So you have one-off ETL point-to-point integrations all across the organization, each one with a different instance of a messaging technology. You know, there's a lot of them out there. Whereas with this, Kafka kind of becomes this data catalog of streams. And then you're able to land those wherever you want. So I could have five different Cassandra tables all sourcing from the same topic. And that really solves a lot of the challenges in hydrating it. And then let's say you come along, if you had a lot of data in there, you can have a certain kind of topic in Kafka that's called a compacted topic. And it sounds a lot like a Cassandra table because it does some of the same things, but it's not for querying because Kafka is not a database. but it is a great way to hydrate things. So it's basically the latest value for every key. So let's say, you know, application team number 5 comes along and says, you know, I want to build a new app. I want to use a new Cassandra cluster because I've got specific latency needs. You can spin up that Cassandra cluster, stand up a connector, hydrate that database, and have it up and running like in less than a day. And that allows you to not have to do, you know, the initial bulk loads that we're all used to and some of the harder parts of standing up a new application database. This can be an on-demand thing. You could just say, hey, here's your topic, give them permissions to that topic, and it's up to that team who owns that application database to stand up their Cassandra. And then they just push a button and they get data flowing into it. And that allows you to quickly rebuild views. They may have a totally different structure they want, so they configure their connector that way. Maybe they create a Streams job, either in Spark or Kafka Streams, to do some sort of enrichment. Do you have a question?
Yeah. Is Kafka joins when you talk about when the data is not there, like a master data, which may not be there in the stream, and you want to join that?
So generally in stream processors, if you do a call out, so I'll repeat the question, sorry. The question was, what do you do if you don't have a stream of the master data as a change data capture stream? Because, you know, somebody told you no. the answer is you should have it or work toward it. But if you can't get it, you can, because it's Java code, make a call out. The problem is because you're processing a partition sequentially, if that call out times out, you have to make a decision. If I can't look up the master data, what do I do? Do I drop the message? Do I write it to a new topic? There are some considerations that make that difficult, which is why having, you know, the master changes coming in is elegant. The other is CDC doesn't put much load on that database. CDC is change data capture, if you're not familiar with the terminology. But it allows you to do that by replaying the log off the database server, so you're not going through the query engine to hit it. So honestly, they'll like you better if you do this, because you're not going to be hitting their database 1,000 times per second to populate that information. So I would recommend for the specific use case getting that feed in. And then what happens is each one of those master feeds get built, everyone else after you already has it. So it kind of iterates off of it. And what you'll see here is this is another topic, which is the API topic that I'm going to get to. You'll see these architectures built out where it snowballs. So the more data is flowing through the system, the more different combinations of it you can get, the more business domains you can cross. And we can start to tear down some of those line of business silos that have been the bane of all architects for forever. Because once it's flowing, it only has to flow once. It's write once, read many. And that is much, much more cost effective, because if that thing over on the left is a mainframe, they pay by the MIP, which is million instructions per second. And it isn't cheap. So that kind of comes into the APIs. So this looks similar in that we have CDC because our APIs need some master data, but we can still change something through the API, right? So we might actually have information being changed in a new microservice API that we've built. So customer goes on the website, he says, you know, my email is now this. The problem is we still need that data back in that red cylinder on the left, because that is our source of truth for the business, and again, you know, rewriting it, not fun. So in the API case, we basically capture writes back into Kafka so that we can both write to Cassandra, because we need the latest value being served out of Cassandra, but also to that source of truth system that we is our master system. Eventually, we turn that left side of this off. I mean, right, we want to go just writing into modern systems, but again, you know, legacy is something we all have to deal with every day. So it allows you to build these architectures where I can fan those updates out both to my new system and my old system so that they're staying in sync over time. And we're able to serve reads really fast, right? So, because what we're trying to do is pull reads off of that system first. Because reads are the most expensive thing on a relational database. They just crush the database. And it doesn't meet the availability contracts, thus, you know, Cassandra being perfect for this. It doesn't meet the latencies required. You might have five of them involved, so you have to write a federated query, and federated queries are only as good as the worst database you've got that they hit. So this kind of solves a lot of that problems. Well, eventually that API can just write directly, and there's nothing going back to that source system. But you know, that's a multi-year journey, because these things built up over 20 years. They're not getting rewritten overnight, and if they work, you're going to have to justify changing it. Pulling reads off, it's going to save somebody tens of millions of dollars within the org. I've heard that over and over again. It's real. So this is a very common pattern that I see. And then you'll have APIs like, you know, customer or patient or claim or, you know, whatever you can come up with. The other beauty of this pattern, though, is that do we really want API for order calling customer for every order it sees? Is that a scalable architecture? That's the microservices conundrum, which is you become a mesh of things all calling each other. What if the order service also had access to all the changes to customer? That way, that Cassandra database backing orders can effectively build in the customer metadata also, in addition to, so if I want order, I just call order. If I want customer, I call customer. They don't have to talk to each other. And this creates a decoupling of your services that allows for independent scalability and other capabilities there. So that's a common gain that you get from this, is you don't have these meshes of microservices that now you have to write custom software to be able to track the flow of your application through it. They can communicate through Kafka, and they can share data through Kafka. And that is the primary gain you get in this kind of architecture. And it's very profound when you start looking at it, in that I've seen a lot of microservices 1.0 projects fail because of this problem, like over and over and over again. So if I had to say the API and the streaming ETL are kind of the things I see over and over and over again across dozens and dozens of places, everyone has these problems. So, and then another one, you know, if you're talking about Cassandra, a lot of people like time series and Cassandra, just a bit. So IoT use cases are really common. And a lot of times you need a way to enrich those events, because what does sensor 5 mean? Where is sensor 5? I don't know. It's not in the event. And this is the same kind of concept as earlier, is you're not just joining together relational sources or microservices and things. These are actually events coming in. You can join them together, you can do some aggregations and so forth on them, and then push them down in a very read-optimized way to Cassandra as these events come in, but you also enrich them with some metadata. So instead of sensor 5, we get it's weather station 5 that's in DC, you know, at these coordinates or something like that, which would have been in that external call if we hadn't have done this kind of approach. So we see a lot of this. There might be an MQTT broker in there somewhere writing to Kafka. That's a really common pattern. And this allows us to do a lot of those joins and filters and aggregations in flight so that we're not putting, you know, the really low granularity data that nobody cares about in your serving layer, you're pre-filtering it so that what goes in there is what people want to query. So that might be, you know, like a 5-minute bar of data. So the average is over all the events in that 5 minute, because that's what the GUI that you build on top of your Cassandra is asking for. So that keeps the footprint there, which makes it easier to manage and allows you to serve more queries out of it, because you're not dealing with reading data you don't care about. Which is always what you want to do in your read system. So this is one that I see a lot. There's probably a little more complexity than the slide adds to an IoT environment, but the core pattern is the same, which is we can do a lot of that stuff in motion on that information to get it down. And it can fan out to other systems too if you have, like, you just want to dump it in a file system somewhere so you keep it in perpetuity for the raw data. That's a pretty common one here. I just kept it simple in this slide. And then log management. So this is a really common use case. So we're in DC, so cybersecurity is a little important around here. I've heard that. So one of the things is you got to be able to see what's going on across all your networks, all your applications, all the things that are going on. Kafka makes it really easy in that there are connectors out there that will listen to syslog messages, format them, put them in Kafka, allow you to join them with your reference data. So, you know, what IP comes in, maybe we do a lookup to the domain DNS service table that we have in here, or, you know, maybe we just want to look at, you know, what customer is that IP or something like that. Join that together, push it down, and then build a search index on it so that you can visualize your logs and look for log issues by using your search API. So this, you know, if you're a DataStax customer, this is Solr. If you're, you know, anybody else, whatever search you want here. But the idea is we're able to prepare this data, aggregate it, push it down. And here's the thing. So what is the biggest challenges with search is back pressure. So when you write to a search technology, indexing is expensive. I'm not sure if you noticed, but indexing is very, very computationally expensive, and data is not smooth. It comes in and bursts. So what this lets you do is keep that information. Kafka is great at throttling for you, because if you can't read it, Kafka will just keep holding it, and you can catch up when you get around to it. So this allows building search indexes to be very consistent in terms of performance over time, at the cost of availability of that data, so you get a lag in when it gets to search. But that's like the number one thing I see for search, is that it's very, very hard to keep the flow of data from overwhelming the search indexer and causing you trouble, especially on things like initial loads and so forth. I may have battled that a few times in my past. So this is a great way to handle that, do some of that aggregation and you know, joining on the data as it flows through, and then make it available in that downstream system in a great way. So, you know, you can do, like, I don't know what the word for it is. It used to be called banana, because that's how we rolled, but on top of Solr or something like that to visualize these logs, look for errors. Look, maybe you run Spark in there somewhere to do some anomaly detection on it or match some of your models or things like that. But you need an aggregation layer for these events, because they come in a way that's probably going to be hard to size for overall, because it's going to be spiky, bursty as it flows. So this is one I see all the time, everywhere. And it's because of, you know, hey, we just want to look at our entire cable company's network and every 15-second snapshot every device on that network. That's a lot of devices. Or, you know, hey, I've got 33 data centers, and, you know, I want to aggregate all that across that. So I have a central pane of glass of every user that comes through and how they traverse my network. You can do those kind of things with this kind of architecture. So I see it a lot. Then that's kind of it for the architectures. Obviously, I'm going to stick around and answer questions. I'm here through tomorrow. So if you find me in the hallway, feel free to pull me aside. I want to share a few resources here. So the first one that's really important is the DataStax Kafka connector. So if you're a DataStax customer, you should get that, try it, get it running. I put the Confluent Connect Hub there too. They have a whole ecosystem of source connectors and other connectors for different systems that allow you to get data in and out of Kafka. My email and Twitter. I'm not really a big Twitter guy. I'm going to have to if I'm going to keep speaking, but I am on there, so that's fine. And then Apache Kafka link. So that's where you go download Apache Kafka. I Wanted to keep it open source today, so everything here is doable with open source, but obviously both DataStax and Confluent offer capabilities around these technologies to make it easier to implement, manage, and run. But I leave that for another talk another day, and happy to answer any questions afterwards. So, and feel free to email me. My email is really hard to remember. It's cliff@confluent.io, so I don't need business cards anymore, which is kind of nice. As I said, happy to help, and really want to hear from individuals on what you're doing with Kafka, what your challenges have been, what's been successful, and so forth. So feel free to seek me out. Thank you very much.